And we have one more milestone to share this morning. This one, a pretty bittersweet one. After 33 years in this building, today is Daryl McIntyre's final day with us.
Yeah, and to honor our 6 o'clock anchor and our friend, we're taking a look back at his career.
And that includes moments that made us laugh.
I can't remember the last time we had 15 degrees as a high.
I don't know. I'll have to look back. But I did want to mention, flurries.
Wow, yeah, she made me snort.
That's not bad. That's a first.
And that's with Carrie Dahl and Richard Osero a few years back. Daryl will join us in studio just after 8:30 this morning to reflect on his award-winning career and what he might be up to next.
Yeah, and this is great. You can also leave your own message for the anchor man. So jump onto our website, click on the Thank You Daryl banner, and submit a message. It's that easy.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. We've been receiving a lot, too. So, and we'll be posting stuff on the website throughout the day as well. So.
Yeah, he'll be making appearances on the shows.
Yeah, well, yeah, as far as I know, yeah, he has to feed the ponies first, and then he'll come in. So
right.
Look forward to that. Okay, as mentioned, Daryl will join us around 8:40. We will have the day's top stories, and we'll put Corey and Jordan to work, too, right after the break.
Instead of weighing the pros and cons of a major decision is to make a list of the good side and the bad side of this decision. Now, an obvious good side, the coins don't rip up nearly as bad as a dollar bill does. On the bad side, though, a coin is useless as a paper airplane. If you do try and throw this thing, you're bound to hurt somebody.
Yeah, even a serious newsman can use his creativity to have some fun. That was Daryl back in 1987 when the Looney was put into circulation. For more than 3 decades, he was the trusted news source that was beamed into thousands of homes in central and northern Alberta. And this is a tough one for our viewers and all of us here at CTV because Daryl's moving on, but he's going to spend a couple of minutes with us. You were telling me when that video was running, you got in trouble for ripping up the dollar bill.
Yeah, you're not supposed to destroy official currency,
no.
By the way, just so you know.
But if you
can rip a loony in half, go for it.
That's impressive,
yeah,
right?
That'd be impressive.
That'd be breaking news right there. You showed up here in 1986.
Yeah, unannounced. I just showed up, walked in, and said, give me a job.
And they did.
Yeah. Didn't work out quite like that. October 27th, 1986, my first day.
And then you were, and we have a little bit of video from a weekend news promo that,
uh-huh.
That you had on the airwaves.
Oh, yeah, see that. Why do people laugh when they see old video of me?
Tell everybody about the tie, though, that you're wearing.
So that tie, I actually, it's hard to see it in that. It's a burgundy tie with a couple little dots on it. And I had that was a tie I wore at Nate, when I went to Nate, and I was practicing anchoring there. I had that tie. When I first started here, I wore it, and I will wear it tonight.
I love it.
I still have it.
And then, so in 86, and this is Daryl throughout the years on the big desk, it was...
Walking and talking. Wow, that's impressive.
Yeah, 1989 that you ended up on the... On the 6 o'clock desk, yes, Monday to Friday with Daphne Kuhn.
Daphne Kuhn, but that was such a privilege to be able to join Daphne. And Al McCann and Eric Neville, absolutely legends back in the day. Daryl and Daph, yeah, that was the first run. We were 6 years together. And then Leslie Miller was the next one to follow up.
And what is that? Yeah,
and Sean Randolph.
And when I showed up,
it's like all
this was
my
a team.
Exes live in Texas.
Exactly.
Carrie Dahl and, of course, Robbie Williams, who I've also been with for a long time. When you first came here, you came as a news anchor, a noon news anchor, right?
Yeah, it was supposed to be with Carrie.
With
and then
Carrie.
About a month in, she bailed for Calgary.
Well, because she was sitting next to a 12-year-old.
I know
if you remember
what
he looked like back then. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, what was gray hair back in the year 2000,
exactly, that's what the other people did. But then Robbie became our 6 o'clock producer for a number of years before moving to CTV.
Yeah.
So we've had a few runs together.
Talked in your ear probably way too much. The one story that I wanted to tell, it was the 2011 PC leadership race that Allison Redford won, and we had provincial coverage, you and Tara Nelson.
Yeah.
It was a Saturday night, and I remember it was dragging on, but we were out of commercial breaks, and I remember getting into your ear and just say, time to fill. Like, we're out of commercials, just go, and you and Tara went forever.
Well, that was fun working with Tara. I hadn't had an opportunity to work with her an awful lot. I'd known her for a lot of years, too, so yeah, we were able to just go, and that's what you do sometimes. It's in broadcasting. You
that's
just keep
right.
on talking until you've got something more interesting to say.
Well, and when there was breaking news hit, you were the trusted voice and face that showed up on TV screens from Mayor Thorpe to the Fort Mac fires to Slave Lake, and sadly, you know, part of the job, we gotta tell these stories, right?
Yeah, absolutely, and you have to tell them with some empathy and with some honesty, and yeah, it's an important part of what we do. That was those were both tough ones.
Oh, for sure. And so was Fort McMurray too, right?
Absolutely,
after 2011 Slave Lake, and then 5 years later when Fort Mac hit.
Yeah, and what it did, we thought we'd seen, you know, one of the worst ever with Slave Lake, and certainly it was bad. There were hundreds of homes that were lost, and then Fort McMurray hit, and that was an entirely different level.
We were talking the other day, and I know news is your first love, but mm-hmm. but you wanted to be a DJ.
I wanted to be a disc jockey when I went to Nate.
Disc jockey, yeah. And then, so that didn't pan out.
I sucked at that.
Yeah, well, no, you would have had great pipes for radio, though.
No, not then. You build these over the years.
Yeah, no, that's true.
And also, I have a cold, which is nice and handy.
Age and experience.
Age and experience. Yeah,
but we were talking the other day when it came to news, it was sports, and there was one trip that you and Adam Cook made in 2006 that
we had fun.
Was actually a highlight for you guys.
Absolutely, it's just so you do so many tough stories and heavy stories. So being able to go and play and follow the Oilers in Raleigh, North Carolina. So we decided that I would head down. Cookie had been following the Oilers through the whole run. But on this one, we knew that there were tons of people from Edmonton that were heading down to Raleigh to watch. There were the buses. So why not do that and cover the story from Raleigh? And then at the same time, I would do all my news stuff during the day. There were 16-hour days. And then I'd back up Cookie at night. So he'd basically cover the Oilers. I'd take care of the Hurricanes, and away we went.
And you guys actually stopped at a restaurant. And
look at that baby Cookie.
I know, eh? Wow.
That's awesome.
A lifetime ago.
Yeah.
You stopped and had a guy by the name of Big Ed fed you guys, like a big North Carolina.
His last name
feed.
Watson. Big Ed Watson. He had one of the most famous restaurants in downtown Raleigh, North Carolina. You ever seen? He carried around a little 5-shooter pistol in his pocket. It was filled with rat shot. So if anybody came upon him, he was quite a character. Guaranteed. And fed us a ridiculous amount of food.
Yeah, exactly. What's next for you?
I have no idea.
No?
Next is going to grab a coffee, hanging out with you guys for the rest of the year. I don't know.
And we'll see. Long lunch.
Long boozy lunch, because I'm almost retired. No, not quite yet. Soon enough. I don't know. We'll see. Probably some diversity. I'm going to find something to do, clearly.
Exactly.
Can't just dog it.
Got to keep paying the bills, right?
Got to keep paying the bills. I've got big dogs, and they eat a lot.
Oh, that's true. What are you going to miss about this place?
You guys, period. Mm-hmm. There's so many memories from being through here. We have one of the guys behind the camera over there, Mike Seymour. To him, I'm just a baby because he's been here for a long time. I've met a lot of pretty extraordinary people over the last 33 years here, and most of them I still work with.
Yeah, well, I've known you for 19, and I'll know you a lot more after that, but from outside of the building here, golfing and playing hockey and goofing
hockey. I'm looking forward to hockey. Are you getting emotional, Rob?
Well,
that's supposed to be my job.
You know what? And Daryl's a great friend. He and his wife Mary came to my wedding when Carly and I got married in the Dominican 11 and a half years ago.
Yeah.
And we laughed and we cried and we carried on. And
we did carry on.
Yeah, no, you've been a great friend to Carly and I and the kids over the years. So.
And will be.
God bless. Oh, for sure. God bless you. You're
Thanks,
not going too far. It's not like you're moving away.
I'm not
out of the
dead
country
yet.
And not taking your
getting closer every day.
Visa but. Away. Yeah.
Aren't we all?
Okay. So we'll.
Okay. McIntyre, stop talking.
No. All good.
Quit hijacking my broadcast.
Daryl will. No, that's fine. You're going to stay around till we end the show.
Yeah.
So, Daryl, by the way, will be on one last time with Aaron Isfeld coming up tonight at 6. So
I will.
There you go. Okay. Put your feet up. We're back in a bit.
I can't. I'm not flexible enough.
There you go.
These chairs are low.
Yeah, I know. Here for the last few seconds with Daryl and the gang, and you'll obviously keep an eye on the news, but sitting there reading the news of the day, that's something you're going to miss too?
There's so many ways to access it that I'll just read Twitter all day.
You can stand in front of the mirror and read.
Hello, I'm Daryl McIntyre. This is what I just read on social media and the CTV Edmonton website.
Which you can go to and send your wishes to Daryl too.
We are saying goodbye today to a friend and someone who our viewers have welcomed into their homes for 3 decades.
That'd be me.
The Northern Affairs Minister says residents should not be too concerned about the possible use of herbicides to control forest growth.
Daryl McIntyre began his career as an anchor and reporter in Lloydminster in 1983. Daryl then came to CFRN in the fall of 86 as a City Hall reporter and weekend anchor. And then in 1989, Daryl took over the 6 o'clock news desk.
Owners of the oldest building still standing in Old Strathcona are planning an anniversary party for tomorrow.
Good evening. An Edmonton City Police stakeout gone bad ended in a shootout and a high
speed. That was a long time ago.
That was a long time ago.
For us.
And yet it seems that long
like
ago.
Like yesterday. Yeah. For us in the CTV newsroom, Daryl is someone we have all looked up to and respected. Daryl, I call you my human Google, don't I?
Daryl, well, why don't you just Google it?
How do I say this, Daryl?
Yeah, it's easy to yell at you.
I'm curious, Daryl. Why did you choose this industry in the first place?
I didn't. I chose to be a disc jockey when I went to NATE. I wanted to be a disc jockey because I was 17 years old, and that seemed like the coolest job that there would be out there. And then I found out I was horrible at it.
No.
Oh, absolutely. You're young, and I didn't have the confidence in personality to be able to push that out over the radio. Right. And I realized that really quickly. But I'd always been good at social studies and English and drama in high school, so that naturally led me toward news. It's current events. It's writing. It's telling stories and being able to present them. So that's what I want to.
Speaking of confidence, tell us the story about one of your first anchor jobs.
Why do you love this story so much?
Because it is awesome. Because I want to look back at that time, and I wish I had that footage of it.
Yeah, well, I'm glad that this does not. So I'd worked in Lloydminster for about a year and a half, and then I got a job in Prince George, which Lloydminster was in my sort of home market. I grew up half in Edmonton, half in Vermilion, and Lloydminster broadcast to Vermilion. So it was my own backyard. It was pretty comfortable there.
Right.
But then I went to Prince George, which to me was a big city. It was 75,000 people.
New ball game.
And it was a long way away. And I was taking over from a local legend at the time, and there had been a memo going out saying, we finally found someone who can take over for this guy.
No pressure.
It was me. No pressure. It was 21 years old. And I went there and I shook the set for 2 weeks. 2 weeks I would get on, and the whole set would shake. The news director after the last time pulled me over and he called me Big Bud. Big Bud, what's going on with you, man? You gotta pull it together. I'm gonna have to let you go. And I figured out a way to pull it together. Because otherwise I'd have lost my job. So that was scary. So sometimes you just got to make sure you don't let fear overtake you. You can't think. You can't do things if you're scared.
You needed confidence.
I needed to kick myself
pull it together, D-Mac.
In the butt. I had to pull it together, yep.
Okay, so 3 decades mm-hmm. in this industry. What are some...
Technically almost 4. Well, it's like 37 years overall.
So 33 here.
Yeah, 33 here.
33 here. So I know you can't pick a favorite, but can you tell us a few stories of some of your most memorable moments?
Let's see. I don't know, there's so many. And we always tend to gravitate toward the sad stories, the disasters, because they are so important. But I'm going to leave those. I've talked about those quite a bit this week in a variety of places. I remember the ones that are fun and come out of the norm, that are different from the norm. So going to Raleigh, North Carolina with Adam Cook to cover the orders. Well, I'm a news guy. I don't get to cover the orders, but we were doing news things there as well. So that was nothing but fun. We had 16-hour days. All we did was just run, and I've never had more fun professionally than that. Mm-hmm. I got to go to New York City and follow little Maddox Flynn and his story as he was getting...
What a story.
And the viewers, when we first put his story on the air, just erupted and gave money to make sure this young man who needed facial surgery had a massive growth on his face. And there was nobody here who could do it quite the way the doctors in New York could. So he ended up going. We followed him through 2 surgeries, actually. So that wasn't fun, but that was gratifying, and it was fascinating, and it was interesting to do. And out of the norm, right?
So
out of
the norm. Off the anchor desk.
Yeah,
a lot of people, you've had a huge impact on our community, of course. A lot of people have been reaching out to you all week.
It's been overwhelming, actually. You know what? And I've seen everything. I've looked at all of the messages. I can't get back to all of them, and I wish I could. But yeah, it's been exceptionally gratifying. But that's, my old buddy Marty Forbes, who was in radio for a million years, always says it's not what you do in broadcasting, it's what you do outside of broadcasting for the community that really gives you a legacy. So anything that I've been able to do has been a privilege and honor, and I needed to do it, so I'm happy to help.
Just lastly, what are you going to miss the most about this industry?
Robbie asked me this morning. Robbie asked me this. You know what I said? I said it was you guys, and it is you guys. It is, yes, there's the brilliance of being able to be connected and informed and knowing what's going on and being able to present it. But in our industry, we work together as a team.
We become a family.
And it becomes like a family in our room. And we're goofy, and we're ridiculous, and sometimes we're dumb off camera. We're trying to make our way through the day. So I will miss that camaraderie that we've had in the newsroom. You can't recreate that.
No, you can't. I look forward to hearing about your new adventure.
So do I. I have no idea what the heck's going to happen.
We'll be in touch. This isn't goodbye.
Oh, really? Okay. Well, see you later. Okay. See, I'm getting goofier as I get closer to the end of this thing.
Daryl, thank you.
My pleasure.
We'll be right back. And that's CTV News at 5 for this Friday. Thanks so much for joining us. CTV News at 6 with Aaron Isfeld and Daryl McIntyre starts right now.
Tonight, fears for what could have been. He flipped me off and pulled up his pants and started running to the back alley.
An attack stopped by a woman who spoke up.
Police under fire for euthanizing a deer on a doorstep.
You kill a animal here. You choke a thing out.
I know, but this is uncalled for.
And an environmentally conscious cemetery.
It's so valuable for our land and our earth and taking care of people in a dignified way.
Staying nice and warm through the weekend, and look up tonight, a once-in-a-lifetime full moon.
CTV Edmonton, local breaking news with Daryl McIntyre and Aaron Isfeld.
Good evening. Edmonton police are calling it an indecent act, but the woman who witnessed the altercation wonders if it might have turned out even more serious.
She ended up scaring away a masked man who was approaching a woman. David Awasik has our exclusive story.
Her name is Morgan Weens, and what she saw a few days ago and what might have happened had she not is still unbelievable to her.
This is in broad daylight at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Yeah. It amazes me. It shocks me.
Morgan says on Wednesday, about 3 o'clock, a young woman was walking down the street in front of her house, and she believes this young woman was being targeted. Morgan says she was watching as well. She says a man, short, heavy set, and white, walked from the alley through her neighbor's yard.
He actually just slowly stepped over here.
And as he saw the female pedestrian, he covered his face and exposed himself.
He pulled down his mask and pulled down his pants and was about to pursue her. And I opened up the window and yelled at him to get his attention and yelled, "Hey," to the woman.
Police say they're currently investigating this but can't add more details. Morgan says she can. She says the woman only stopped briefly, the masked man as well, before fleeing.
He flipped me off and pulled up his pants and started running to the back alley where his vehicle was parked.
Morgan says this is the type of vehicle he fled in, a black Jeep Patriot. This image is from a security camera very close by on Wednesday, right around 3 o'clock in the afternoon. David Awasik, CTV News.
Runners in Edmonton's River Valley are showing there is strength in numbers tonight. Police have been warning us about a man committing indecent acts against women there. Police have received 14 reports of women being approached and harassed by a man doing some strange things. Sometimes he grabs them or exposes himself. Investigators say women who have been accosted by the man describe him as about 5'7" with dark hair and dark skin. Two runs have been organized tonight, empowering people to take back the trails.
It's not about vigilante justice. It's just about raising awareness and getting people together to introduce them to other runners. So I know women runners don't always feel safe running alone, but sometimes if you don't know a lot of people in your community who run, or you're not familiar with some of the running groups, it's hard to know when to go for a run.
Now, police have released this photo of someone they are only calling a person of interest in this case.
Residents of a Fort Saskatchewan condo building forced to evacuate last month are now allowed to go back in to at least get the rest of their belongings. This is still a very slow process. The building has been deemed unsafe, so there are strict rules that mean many still have to wait before they can go get their things. Amanda Anderson explains.
A moving truck pulls up to the Riverview Estates condo building to help the first of several residents forced to move out.
It's horrible. It really is. We get the frustration that some of the people have felt, but there's really not much we can do about it.
The building isn't safe. It was evacuated in early August after several floor joists, which help support the building's weight, were found to be damaged or not constructed properly.
We don't think right now for a minute that it's going to be a teardown.
The condo board says work is underway to see how widespread the problem is. According to documents obtained by CTV News, while Nova Construction was building it, safety officers stopped by at least 10 times between July 2002 and April 2003 to make sure it was up to code. On July 8th, there are notes about the floor joists and plywood in place on the first floor, but there was no mention of any issues. The lawyer for the condo corporation issued a statement saying the legal analysis and assessment of liability will continue and requires the outcome of the engineering investigation.
In the meantime, only one resident can move out each day, starting with the fourth floor.
I believe it has to do with the weight bearing. So they're trying to lighten the load because they're still working downstairs on the first floor.
The moving process will continue until the end of October. Some people who own units inside the building are leaving their stuff behind, hopeful the issue will be resolved and they can return home. Amanda Anderson, CTV News, Fort Saskatchewan.
And if you'd like more background on this story, you can head to our website, ctvnewsedmonton.ca.
The Medicine Hat Police Service is defending one of its own officers who euthanized a deer with a knife on someone's doorstep. A warning that some viewers may find this video disturbing, though we have blurred out sections of it.
You f***ing kill a f***ing animal here. You choke a f***ing thing out. I know, but this is f***ing uncalled for.
The man who recorded this video says he's upset the officer used a knife to put the animal down and plans to file a complaint. Police say fish and wildlife officers were not available, and they say the deer was injured. Officers decided the most humane action would be to euthanize it. One officer can be heard on the video explaining that it wasn't safe to use a gun because of how close they were to other homes. Medicine Hat Police say it supports the officer's actions.
Four people are facing charges after a drug bust earlier this week. The four were out on bail at the time and were being monitored by police when officers say they noticed behavior that would be consistent with drug trafficking. On Wednesday, police searched two homes in West Edmonton and seized approximately $370,000 worth of drugs, plus a handgun and ammunition also found in a hidden compartment in a car parked nearby.
Students at a school east of Edmonton are returning to their classrooms after fire damaged the building last month. The blaze broke out on the roof of Central High Sedgwick Public School on August 14th. The school board hoped to have that building ready for September 3rd. However, the smoke and water damage was far too extensive. High school students were placed in a nearby recreation center. However, kindergarten to grade 9 students did not hit the books until this week. Moving portable trailers onto the school site, Camp Sedgwick was created to house all of the students on that same site. Officials hope the school will be open by this spring.
The Alberta Securities Commission has settled now with the Lutheran Church of Canada. This is over an investment scheme that was mismanaged for almost a century. The Alberta and BC chapter of the Lutheran Church ran an investors fund. That fund helped to build churches, schools, and retirement communities, and many investors were seniors who depended on returns for income. In 2015, that fund underwent bankruptcy protection, and about 2,600 investors were out $95 million. The individuals who were named in the case have now agreed to pay $500,000 for distribution to all the investors and $100,000 to the Securities Commission in order to cover costs.
These days, many are trying to be more environmentally conscious. Now there's a way to do that in death as well. The city's first green burial site has opened on the south side. Article Weisberg has the details.
And the cemetery opened in 1999.
Okay.
So it's 20 years this year.
An anniversary that also marks the start of a new service at Rose Hill Cemetery, one that brings the dead closer to nature.
The whole mindset is that there is nothing remaining and that you're basically returning this area back to nature.
The Meadows of Rose Hill is a one-acre site that's been set aside specifically for green burial.
There's no use of embalming chemicals to preserve the body for, you know, an extended period of time, so you're promoting that decomposition to take place. There's no use of concrete burial vaults.
A certified biodegradable casket or shroud must be used. There's a common memorial rock instead of individual markers, and native grass and plants are grown on graves instead of traditional grass seed.
The other options that are available, cremation or traditional burial, each in their own way do have an impact on the environment, whereas this is really the only true option that has minimal impact.
Debbie Herring has been lobbying for greener burial options for years.
But even as a child, I just would go to some funerals with my parents or whatever, and the face, the embalming, the very fancy, elaborate coffins were actually almost repulsing to me. So I just said, there's got to be something more natural.
Now that that's available, both she and her husband have told their kids, when the time comes, this is how they'd like to go.
I seriously just think it's so valuable for our land and our earth and taking care of people in a dignified way.
Two city-owned cemeteries are also planning to offer natural burials and biodegradable urns in the coming years. Nicole Weisberg, CTV News, Edmonton.
Alberta MLAs will be returning to the legislature a little earlier than planned. The government announced this morning that the fall sitting of the legislature will begin October the 8th. A news release says House Leader Jason Nixon has sent a request to the Speaker, Nathan Cooper, to convene a couple of weeks earlier than was originally on the fall calendar.
As you likely know, a couple of weeks ago, Daryl McIntyre announced that he was leaving CTV News after 33 years. Now, this is your final CTV News at 6 broadcast. You're wearing something tonight to mark this occasion.
A flashy tie from circa 1981, as a
you
matter of fact.
You would never know it.
Apparently, I'm a sentimental pack rat because I have worn this tie at a variety of places. So we actually have a picture of me at Nate. It was with my good friend Barb Higgins, who ended up anchoring in Calgary for a number of years.
Your posture could have been better.
Yeah, I said, well, so could the part in my hair that was horrible. But either way, we were just messing around on that one. But that's the tie I'm wearing tonight. I also wore it later in my first job at Lloydminster. I wore it in Prince George in that job and when I did my first newscast, and I wore it here when I did my first few newscasts on the weekends at CFRN. So it's been my tie. It's been with me, and I thought it was poetic to have it on the last one.
Where do you keep that at home?
It's just hanging off the dresser.
Just hanging.
Hanging around. Just look at it every now and then. Anyway, so, and you know what? It's held up pretty well. It's a little short. Like, in order to get a decent knot on it.
Not
let's
bad,
just
though.
Leave that between us, shall we?
See what our stylist says about that.
She'll like it.
Nice she retro. Will
like it's a Mad Men look.
Looking good tonight.
Yeah,
we've got so much more on Daryl's last broadcast here tonight. And we also have a way for you to reach out to Daryl as well. Many of you have been watching him for decades. So head to our website, ctvnewsedmonton.ca, and click on Send a Message. All right, let's get our first check on your forecast now.
Looking good. Josh Clausen, you're a rookie. You've only been here 16 years, buddy.
Only 16 years, yeah. You know, I was thinking I was 10. 33 years ago. I don't want to rub that in.
But no, it's fine.
That's
you growed up real good.
You've been the anchor as long as I've known.
Nice
to be here on your last night. It was a beautiful day weather-wise. Today started off with some clouds and some scattered showers mid-morning, and then the sun broke through the clouds this afternoon. 21 degrees right now downtown, 21 as well across most of the city. A little cooler there in Otwell at 19. It's even cooler at the International Airport. 18 degrees right now with wind out of the west at about 15 kilometers per hour. Just a nice gentle breeze. 21 so far, your daytime high for today. We'll have the official number for you later in the newscast. 11 degrees this morning, so well above average this morning, and about 4 degrees warmer than average this afternoon. 17, the average daytime high. 1 year ago, plus one, with some snow on the ground. 9 degrees tomorrow morning, should be up to about 21 tomorrow afternoon. Again, mostly cloudy skies and a slight chance of some scattered showers in the morning and then clearing through the afternoon hours. It is a historic night tonight. Not only Daryl's last newscast, but Triskaidekamicro Micro Harvest Moon. We'll break it all down in just a few minutes.
Thank you, Josh. Stay with us. Coming up, Felicity Huffman goes from prime time to having to do time.
Also, a Canadian Olympic star now trying to compete for the U.S.
She didn't come to this decision, you know, easily.
And an RCMP intelligence director charged with breaking Canada's official secrets law.
Well, Daryl, it's been great serving the community alongside you. And in addition to reporting the news, you've given so much back to the community. And on behalf of Edmontonians, I'm grateful for your service to our community.
MP has arrested and charged one of its own members with serious espionage-related offenses.
CTV's Annie Bergeron-Oliver has more tonight on the charges that have left the intelligence community stunned.
Sources say it is extremely rare for charges to be laid under the Security of Information Act, and just as rare for the RCMP to charge one of its own. Cameron Ortiz was a director general of a top intelligence unit within the RCMP. And the force says the charges stem from activities alleged to have occurred during his time as a civilian member. The 47-year-old was arrested in Ottawa last night and made his first court appearance today. He's now facing decades in jail and seven charges that stem back to 2015. Three charges are related to gaining, obtaining, and communicating special operational information. He's also facing two criminal charges, one related to unauthorized use of a computer.
In broad strokes, the allegations are that he obtained, stored, processed sensitive information, we believe, with the intent to communicate it to people he shouldn't be communicating it to.
A civilian member of the RCMP's intelligence team, Ortiz would have had access to top secret and highly classified material and information about ongoing investigations. His vast array of published work focused on cybersecurity in East Asia, Somalia, policing, cyberspace, and critical infrastructure. His LinkedIn also says he spoke Mandarin.
We're dealing with operational matters. It doesn't say it at the moment, but you can only presume it's dealing with a foreign entity where possible harm to national interests, the Canadian interests, are at play.
Ortiz was in court today, but he appeared by video link from the courthouse basement. He does not have a lawyer at the moment and will remain in custody until his next appearance 1 week from today. Annie Bergeron-Oliver, CTV News, Ottawa.
The three major federal party leaders made policy pitches today, trying to grab votes on day three of the election campaign.
Liberal leader Justin Trudeau targeting small business owners. Conservative leader Andrew Scheer pledging a tax credit for transit users. And the NDP's Jagmeet Singh making a promise to address cell phone and internet costs. But it's the Conservative leader who continues to be criticized by his rivals for a comment about an Indigenous community holding up the progress of pipelines during last night's debate. Today, he softened his tone.
When you see those First Nations communities so frustrated that those projects are not able to proceed because a small group of people or other Indigenous communities are holding up those projects, I sense that frustration.
I deplore the perspective and the language that he used.
I mean, that's just inflammatory language.
Singh, Trudeau and Scheer are all now heading back to Ottawa.
Actress Felicity Huffman was sentenced to 14 days in jail today for her role in the college admissions scandal.
She'll also have to pay a $30,000 fine and do 250 hours of community service. Huffman pleaded guilty in May to a single count of conspiracy and fraud, admitting she paid $15,000 to have her daughter's SAT scores falsified. A Desperate Housewives star appeared in Boston's federal court today, telling the judge she would accept whatever punishment was given. Prosecutors recommended 1 month in jail and a $20,000 fine. Huffman's lawyer asked for a year probation, 250 hours community service, and the $20,000 fine. Canadian Olympic gold medalist Kaylee Humphreys says she wants to compete now for the United States.
And she is also suing Bobsleigh Canada Skeleton to make that happen after filing a harassment complaint. Humphreys, seen here on the left, has won two gold medals. She filed a harassment complaint with BCS last year, alleging her coach verbally and mentally abused her. But that investigation hasn't been resolved. She is suing for $45 million in damages and lost income and to get released from her contract so that she can join the American team after she marries an American in San Diego this weekend.
They seem to want to duke this out in court and, want to continue to make Ms. Humphrey's life as miserable as possible, notwithstanding, her outstanding service to this country. It's just completely despicable.
In a statement, Humphrey says that she wants to be clear that she's not choosing to leave Canada. She says she loves this country, but simply feels she can no longer be part of what she calls an unsafe work environment.
Coming up, Connor McDavid hits the ice, eliminating some of the fears that he might not be ready for the season.
The way he was competing, the way he was working, he's ready to rock by the looks of it.
I want to thank you for those memories. I want to thank you for being a brilliant teacher and a mentor. And I want to thank you for all the times you made me laugh. I love you, my friend, and I know whatever you do next, you are going to be a massive success. Mwah. All the best to you.
So look.
Looking back now from the perspective of 2019 in New York City, I probably should have described Daryl McIntyre as my mentor all those years ago, but
I mean, I was 22, he was 26. We were just two guys in the same office, but he was the veteran who was just so good at what he did. Election nights and budget days and breaking news and just an ordinary regular news day. Thank you, Daryl, for letting me soak it all in and learn so much.
Greetings from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Hi, Daryl, it's me, Ian Leonard, your favorite weatherman. Sorry, Josh. You know, all those years ago when we were on the set every night at CFRN-TV, now CTV Edmonton, you said something to me after my first month or so on the air. You said, don't fake it, because the one time you forget to fake it, everybody's going to know that you're not genuine. Everybody knows, Daryl, that you're genuine. You're a genuine journalist. You're one of the few left on the air. You're a genuine good guy, and you're a genuine friend.
And that's why all those people send in all of those messages, right?
Yeah, that's awesome.
They connected with you all of these years.
They kept in touch with you. Yeah, and they're still sticking around. I've had them buffaloed for like decades. It's been amazing. Been awesome.
You gotta ride some of that now.
You're my favorite weatherman.
Yeah, we all know Osro's your favorite.
Yes.
Shout out Richard
Osro. He gives him some free honey.
Good honey.
Yeah, that's
right. Richard Osro. Good morning, honey.
All right, listen, I don't want to steal your shine, but there's something else big going on tonight.
It's a big deal.
It's all because of this. I think that's how this all came together.
You put this together with McIntyre's last night. This is never going to happen again. And what happens in the sky, it will never happen in your lifetime again. Looks like the last time this might have happened was 1867. We're calling it a Triskaidekka micro harvest moon. Triskaidekka, Greek for 13. Micro, full moon, when it's at the apogee, the furthest point in its orbit. So it's going to appear smaller. And then harvest moon, because it's the full moon closest to the autumn equinox. We're not certain. The last harvest moon that was on a Friday the 13th was 1867. The last full moon on a Friday the 13th was only back in 2000. Who cares about that one? The last time all of these lined up, though, we're not sure. Maybe 1867. We just don't know if that was a micro moon. That's what you have to look forward to later tonight. Should be visible after about 20 after 8 tonight. So you get partly cloudy skies outside right now. 19 degrees after hitting 21 for a daytime high. I think partly cloudy for the rest of this evening. And then after about 10, 11 o'clock tonight, you might see some increase in cloud. 18 in Fort McMurray, 20 in Grand Prairie. It's 18 in Red Deer for a daytime high today. So into the low 20s yesterday and again today. And I think low 20s again for tomorrow. We had some scattered showers and thunderstorms popping up this afternoon in southeastern Alberta. Had a few earlier in the day in through the foothills. And you can see there is still some thicker cloud cover off to the west of us. We'll hope that heavier cloud cover holds off until after about 9, 10 o'clock tonight. Futurecast thinks it will, showing some increase in cloud after about 11 o'clock. So when you wake up tomorrow morning, mostly cloudy skies, chance of some scattered showers off to the west of the city, maybe a hit and miss shower in and around the Edmonton area about 9, 10 o'clock in the morning. So very similar to what we had today. More cloud than sunshine in the morning, and then more sun than cloud through the afternoon. Chance of scattered showers across northern Alberta, maybe through the Elbow area as well. And then Sunday, chance of scattered showers in northwestern Alberta and through western parts of the province. But for the Edmonton area, areas off to the south and east, just partly cloudy skies. Temperatures, again, close to 20 for a daytime high on Sunday. So nice and warm for the second last weekend of summer. 18 degrees right now in Fort McMurray, 19 in Grand Prairie, 19 in Edmonton. And we've slipped to 17 in Red Deer, Coronation, and Lloydminster. Temperatures overnight tonight falling to about 9 degrees. Partly cloudy skies through this evening. Check out the Triskaidekka micro harvest moon. And then 21 for a daytime high tomorrow afternoon and a little bit of clearing later in the day. 19 or 20 on Sunday with partly cloudy skies. 16 Monday, chance of showers late in the day Monday. 17 and 18 for highs Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. That puts us back to around average for the start of next week. Look at the end of next week. Warming up again for the last weekend of summer. Autumn equinox is right here, 23rd of September this year. 20 for the start of autumn and that last weekend of September, last weekend of summer rather, daytime highs around 20 degrees. That's what you have this weekend as well. Partly cloudy skies tonight. Check out the full moon after the party tonight. and then enjoy the next couple of days.
Great stuff.
Thank you, Josh.
Yeah. Thanks, Josh. Edmonton Oilers hit the ice for the first official practice, a main training camp, and the captain was in full flight.
There has been a lot of speculation about Connor McDavid's recovery from a knee injury. But as Adam Cook reports, he looks to be right back up to speed.
Cleared for contact and clear for liftoff. Connor McDavid was not wearing a non-contact jersey and seemed to have no issues as he took part in all drills during his first full practice with the team since injuring his left knee, and he was at full speed.
Complicated summer, lots of stuff going on. Lots of different opinions, so there was times where it was definitely in doubt. As right now, it's good.
The way he was competing, the way he was working, he's ready to rock by the looks of it.
Riding shotgun with McDavid for now is number 44, known as a rugged player with good hand, speed, and size, described as a bottom six forward in recent years, but Zach Cassian is getting another chance to play on the Oilers' top line with the captain and Leon Draisaitl.
I don't think he gets enough credit for how good of a hockey player he is. Like, he can play, and he's fun to play with. He gets in there, but he makes plays. He sees the ice very well.
The 28-year-old and former first-rounder is in the final year of his contract. He was elevated to the top line late last season and produced a career-best 15 goals. New head coach Dave Tippett has said that he expects big things from the 9-year NHL veteran, but also warned the media not to read into line combinations too much. Cassian is taking the same approach.
Definitely a lot of eyes on us. Well, obviously, I've been given a pretty good opportunity here. Obviously, you want to do well with it, but I've been around the league long enough where if you're not producing, you don't earn, that job can get taken pretty quickly, so I don't read too much into it.
From a bottom six role to another shot on the top line, that's how training camp starts for Cassian.
I think I'm a unique player. I think as you spend more time in the league, you really get to know who you are, and I honestly see myself as a guy that can play anywhere.
Adam Cook, CTV News.
Ah, the great Daryl McIntyre. No, the word legend doesn't even do him justice. He's beyond a legend. He's in like a category all his own. I don't know what is greater than a legend, but whatever that word is, first of all, Daryl knows what word that is, but he is that.
Thanks for being a friend and a good mentor all these years at CTV, and I wish you the best in your future endeavors.
We begin tonight with bittersweet news of national importance. Not even the election campaign could bump this story from the lineup. CTV News Edmonton's Daryl McIntyre is retiring from the anchor desk after 33 years. Now, Daryl got his start when he was really young. Okay, not that young. He's respected and revered not only in Edmonton, but across Alberta. Even Calgary loves him. And Daryl, while you'll be spending a lot more time on your acreage with your wife, Mary, and riding your horse, we have it on very good authority, you'll also be clocking the kilometers on your motorcycle. There better be a sunset involved. You've earned it. So at the end of this remarkable chapter and the start of your next one, from all of us at CTV National News, best wishes, my friend. And congratulations.
Yes, we are saying goodbye to a man who has been in our homes for decades, bringing you the stories of our city, the nation, and the world for more than three decades. Daryl has been a journalist and a broadcaster for nearly 37 years, and there is simply no easy way to sum up his entire career on this broadcast. But we tasked our Dan Grummet with giving you just a small sense of what Daryl's done and what he's meant to all of us.
The city has changed a lot in three plus decades.
Good evening, our big story tonight.
So too has broadcast news.
Good evening, thanks for joining us tonight.
How we gather it, how you get it, the screens we watch it on.
The Fort McMurray wildfire.
But here in Edmonton, inside the TV frame, there's been one constant.
CTV Edmonton. Local breaking news with Daryl McIntyre.
Good evening and welcome to 2855. I'm Daryl McIntyre.
After graduating from Nate, Daryl McIntyre began his career as an anchor and reporter in Lloydminster in the fall of 1983.
Good evening, I'm Daryl McIntyre. For the past 19 years, children across Canada have had their imagination stretched and been entertained by a gentleman called Mr. Dress-Up. For Midwest Television News, I'm Daryl McIntyre.
Military police kept the demonstrators from moving any closer than the outer perimeters of the base.
After a year and a half stint on the 6 o'clock news in Prince George, he made the move to Edmonton and CFRN-TV in the fall of 86. He was hired as the City Hall reporter and weekend anchor.
Because news doesn't just happen Monday through Friday.
He had a natural voice. A lot of people don't have that, and being an anchor, you have to have that.
Good evening.
In 1989, Daryl took up the flagship broadcast, the 6 o'clock news.
Four people they believe to be armed robbers. The Black Friday tornado.
He'd remain there.
A controversial restaurant.
For the next
Eyewitness News.
30 years.
With Daryl McIntyre and Leslie Miller.
A warning tonight for women to use one of our city's most popular parks.
He was a constant. You know, it's one of those things in life. Oh, 6 o'clock, Daryl.
Here are Daryl McIntyre and Kerry Dahl.
Time spanning 11 Oilers captains.
The lowest interest rate.
8 federal elections. Years.
But it's still 10% unemployment.
Good evening. Welcome to CTV Edmonton special coverage of the.
And 9 provincial ones.
Never really believed it. It is a historic call. An NDP majority. RCMP say they have now pinpointed a suspect.
He made us all look good so many times.
I'm a fool.
But it's not like he was chained to the desk.
Maybe if he just came straight ahead, maybe then I could stop him.
He signed the waiver.
Don't bite.
But maybe not.
I've never had grits in my life. I heard about them a million times. What do you think of grits?
I don't know. I was more kind of struck by the gravy, the red-eye gravy.
Not even the surgeon, Dr. Milton Wainer, thought that Maddox would bounce back this quickly, but he has.
Right in the heart of the Grey Cup Festival. It is away from the studio. Daryl is at his best. Those moments, we turn to the TV4.
We are covering an unprecedented story in our country, and so we thought it best to bring CFRN News to the community of Mayerthorpe.
That is where I think he shines through his greatest, is in times of breaking news.
I'm reporting live from a roadblock just outside of Slave Lake.
He was better without scripts.
Coverage of the Fort McMurray wildfire, clearly a catastrophe in every sense of the word.
That's where his craft and just his integrity really come out.
Daryl McIntyre, CTV News, Edmonton.
In 2017, he was named Best Local News Anchor at the Canadian Screen Awards.
You can argue that many came before him, but I feel like he really set the standard and expectation of what a newsman should be.
Daryl the anchor man, you know. Daryl the man, well, you kind of know him too.
What you see is what you get with Daryl McIntyre.
Eat right and exercise.
I don't want to boil your whole world down to a rather simple equation.
But all is not perfect.
Wow.
Meteorologist Josh Clausen will be there here, somewhere, eventually in a place where he needs to be.
I did want to mention flurries. And,
wow, yeah, she made me snort. More energetic music than normal, wasn't it?
That?
Quite Christmas music.
He used to sing in the commercial breaks. We had acronyms for how he was feeling. He's funny. Like, he's, you know, he's funny.
Where are you shooting? Are you shooting my big ass bald spot? You need to stop.
One more.
I mean, there's no pompous anchor man. He's just, yeah, good old Daryl. He might even break out his guitar and sing.
And remember all those times we ran free.
A popular method of weighing the pros and cons of a major decision is to make a list of the good side and the bad side.
Local breaking news.
The timing is bad for journalism.
Good evening, Bob.
The departure of 3 decades of knowledge and experience will leave a void in local news in Edmonton. But Daryl McIntyre's legacy will help fill it.
What we do now without him will always have a tiny piece of him as part of how we cover things.
Dan Drummond, I was loving every bit, and I was thanking you, and I was thinking, what a wonderful thing for you to do. And then you put that little bit in from Nate right at the end.
Well, you have to come full circle.
stage?
I'll never be able to go anywhere now.
Is it incredible when you look at that and see the span of almost 40 years?
I've been around a long time, you little lady. It's been a long time, but it's been very gratifying. Dan, thank you for that. And it's great to go back all over those memories and so many people and so many things. And so many people say nice things. You're very nice. Thank you.
Absolutely. Okay.
More okay, now what?
Daryl. In just a bit. We'll be back in a moment.
You've been a mentor to me and so many others, a trusted journalist for everyone who has turned to you over the years. Best of luck to you. You will be missed. And the next time I'm in E-Town, beers are on me.
I just want to say congratulations on 33 fabulous years at CTV Edmonton. You had a great run, and I was privileged to sit beside you at the anchor desk for 2.5 of those years, from 1995 to 1997. You raised the bar for news in Edmonton. Your passion and integrity as a journalist, you made me a better journalist.
Well, this is a tough day for us. Quite emotional as it is, Daryl McIntyre's last broadcast with us. But it is also a reason to celebrate and thank Daryl for everything that he has done for CTV News over the years.
I personally rebuilt the station into the beautiful edifice that it is now here in West Edmonton along Stony Plain Road.
I love that you're taking credit for so many things tonight.
Why not?
It's perfect. Okay, well, we are having a party here to celebrate Daryl's career.
Well, we're working.
They're partying.
Yeah.
You know, there's plenty of former coworkers upstairs here to honor a man that we lovingly call D-Mac. Our Graham Neal is out there tonight in the CTV atrium. So how is the party so far?
The party is amazing. Daryl, you did a great job building this station, by the way, the new atrium. But look, have a look around, Daryl. If you think you're not loved, think again. Look at all these people coming for the party. Apparently, I was charged a $50 cover charge to get to the party. Gladly pay it. Gladly play it for your retirement party. But yeah, like you guys said, friends, family, co-workers, like Brian Marshall. 48 years at the station. Sorry to one-up you, Daryl, but you were there for his first newscast. And what did you think? Thought this guy's never going to make it?
I thought, we're hiring teenagers now. And now he's older than the totem pole, so, you know.
There it is, Daryl McIntyre, older than the totem pole. You heard it first, but there it is. It's kind of an end of an era, though.
It is. He was like a doorstop, you know. They pulled it out, and the door's going to close. But another door's going to open, so.
There it is. Well, high praise from Brian Marshall. Look at this. So sports guys, we had Ryan, we had Adam, Chris, Robbie Williams. What do you think, Daryl, celebrating Daryl's last day here?
Yeah, I remember the first time he talked to me. It was my second year at CTV, and just really meant a lot to me. So, D, you know, thanks for being there for me after year one.
Look at that, Ryan Rashad. Adam, you spent many, many, many years on the desk with Daryl.
Absolutely.
Not having him on that desk again, hey?
Oh, it's going to be brutal, and I'm going to miss his help as far as pronunciation guides.
Yeah.
I have a real hard I still can't pronounce Bosnia-Herzegovina or something like that.
Yeah.
He was very good at helping me with that kind of stuff, but he'll be missed. We love him.
You're absolutely right. You still can't pronounce it. But Daryl, if you're wondering what waits up for you, what's waiting for you, look at this. Here it is. Your retirement. This is a cake. Your retirement cake right there. I felt when I baked it. Maybe I left it in the oven a little bit too long, but I think it turned out perfectly. But look at this, Daryl. I wonder, are you going to do like a cake smash with that? Who would want to cut this?
I don't know. I think we just all go up and lick it.
Oh, well, you know what? I beat you to the punch on that one. But anyway, congratulations, Daryl, and a pleasure to work with you for so long, and pleasure to stand beside your cake.
Awesome. Great,
I'll
thank you.
I'll see you in a few minutes, too.
Thanks.
Keep your fingers off the cake.
So many people want to talk to you about your career here at CTV Edmonton.
Yeah, it's been really nice.
Of course, including our friends at CTV Morning Live.
Yeah.
How early did you have to get up?
Early enough. I've been wearing this shirt way too long. It's almost disgusting because I've been up since 7-ish or 6:37. It's a little early. Anyway.
Well, here's a little bit of that interview with Rob Williams.
What are you going to miss about this place?
You guys, period. There's so many memories from being through here. We have one of the guys behind the camera over there, Mike Seymour. To him, I'm just a baby because he's been here for a long time. I've met a lot of pretty extraordinary people over the last 33 years here, and most of them I still work with.
Well, throughout our broadcast, we have heard from so many people. Everybody wanting to sort of throw those accolades out at you. Really nice. I know that many.
Well, Twitter is blowing here, right? up right now. People are crying watching this broadcast. The number of people that have texted us to say goodbye to you is incredible. And a testament to who you are, right?
Well, it's a long period of time for something to be consistent. And change, it can be sometimes a little bit difficult to deal with. So, but we'll deal with it. And I've got change. I'm going to find something to do. Yeah, somewhere.
Don't know just yet?
No, I don't know. I'm going to take a lot of time. Take some time and
reflect on all of the happy moments.
Yes, and read all the very nice things that people are, all that kind of stuff.
Well, so you're going to need probably a year to go through all of the comments. And, you know, obviously, I don't think I probably is speaking for you as well. For us to sit here on this desk with you has been such a privilege.
Oh,
and he's second to none, right? Like, honestly.
Honestly.
It's been hard listening to all this because I don't, you know, you don't want false humility, but I'm certainly extremely appreciative of all that stuff. What about the fact that we're going to talk about fun stuff here at the end?
Okay, do you
not get all sucky and stuff?
I guess that's what we want to
ask. Roll this, because we were talking about what are the fun things you do? Well, last night, so she has to stand on a box next to me because she's too short.
Oh.
She fell off last night. Now, I don't know, some of you may have noticed, but we just kept on going because that's what we do in broadcasting. I could watch that over and over and over again.
Okay, we want to give you, obviously, the final
word. You going to sing again for us?
I'm not going to sing, my friends. Won't be that song, that's for darn sure.
Yeah.
Instead, we'll look back a little bit. You know, when you're 17 years old and you're walking into NAIT for your first time as a radio and television arts student, you're not thinking about what life is going to be like nearly 40 years down the road. You're hoping just to find a place in the world. You're hoping to find a career so you can be fed and you can be housed. You're hoping to learn the ropes, decide on a path. Get a job. Each day you try to learn from the people who have had more experience than you. You try to earn their confidence and their trust, and you hope eventually their respect. I have a lot of people who have had faith in me as a broadcaster over the years, particularly a guy by the name of Bruce Hogle, who hired me here at CFRN nearly 33 years ago. He was also the guy who pushed me and encouraged me to expand my career through doing things like special reports. There was a political talk show that I used to host. It was a lot of fun. Lots of live events. I learned so much during my early years here that have certainly served me well a little later on. Now, I have a lot of exes. I have a current one, and I have a lot of exes. But I was talking with one of them today, Carrie Dahl, and she asked me, who was your greatest teacher? And it was kind of an interesting question, and it was one that at the time I really couldn't answer, at least until I realized my greatest teacher was everyone. I learned by watching people like Harvey Kirk and Lloyd Robertson and Peter Jennings. I learned from everyone that I could, and I tried to take the best of what they did and adapt it. So it's been important to me as I gained the years to give that to my younger colleagues, support and encouragement, sometimes a kick in the butt, that I received over the years. So over the last few weeks, I've had a lot of messages from an awful lot of people I've worked with over the years who told me that I did have an impact, and I am very proud of that particular fact. Now, messages from you viewers, those have been gratifying beyond my ability to express it. So thank you. I've read almost all of the comments that have come through. I'll get through them all through the website, through emails, through tweets, through Facebook messages, Instagram, on and on and on and on. I'm sorry I haven't been able to respond to all of them. And speaking of going on and on and on, I don't want to drone on for you tonight. But I want you to know I'm very proud of the team that we have here. You can count on them to keep bringing you the news of the day and more beyond that. Now we'll certainly be relying on them over the next several weeks. Yeah, I got into this business wishing one thing. I wanted to do the best job I could, wanted to do that every day. So when the career finally came to an end, people might just say he was a hell of a newsman. I feel pretty good about that tonight. So thank you for watching. Good night.
Well said. He is a hell of a newsman. Well done.
All right, throw some music or something.